Before heading to the video, if you haven't subscribed the channel, do subscribe it and don't forget to click the bell icon for the latest update notification. If you like the video, do like, comment and share. Stay tuned with learnbay.co. Happy learning.
So today's topic is random forest and we will try to finish it today itself. We'll not stretch it more than one class now onwards. So we will see what all things we need to study into random forest, one of the most important topic as per the interview perspective. Okay, a lot of time you will get the questions from random forest algorithm itself. So we'll see what is random forest, learning objectives are what is ensembling model, what is bagging, random forest algorithm, out of bag error rate, finding optimal number of trees and finding optimal number of variables to select. So we will see what each of these things are. So, okay, some concepts. So ensemble is basically use of multiple learning algorithms to obtain better predictive performance that could be obtained from any of the constituent learning algorithm. So this thing we will discuss after 40-45 minutes. Bootstrap aggregation is also called as bagging, given that training set of D of size N. Okay, this also we will discuss after 10 minutes, because this definitions you guys will not be able to understand until unless I will not tell you the fundamentals. So wait for these two definitions. We will come back onto this. Random forest is a ensemble technique. Involves constructing of multitude of decision trees at training time. Prediction is based on mode for classification tree and mean for regression tree. Help reduce overfitting. So now what happens? Random forest is basically a technique which is based on decision tree. So generally what happens into random decision tree, in random forest, many decision trees we will be creating. And then we create a random forest. Now, why this random forest has been required when we are having a decision tree available? The reason is basically, so we spoke about that Gini gain calculation in decision tree. So it is basically based on the target variable. Now, if I will vary the proportion of target variable, zeros and ones, my split will change. Yes or no?
Yes.
So when I will vary the zero or one proportion, then my split will also change. So tomorrow, if there is a new data set coming today, whatever feature is coming as at the first place might be coming in a third place. So basically, we are not sure into the decision tree algorithm, okay, which particular parameter will be surely coming as a first, another which will be second and third splits and so on. So basically, to avoid that kind of issue, we came up with a new random forest algorithm where with different kind of parameters, we are creating a multiple decision trees internally. And then we do the prediction of 0 and 1 for the observation. So how we do, what we will do. So basically what happens now in decision random forest, what happens? Simple structure I will give you. So suppose this is your random forest. Okay. This is your forest. Now in this forest, you will be having different trees. Okay. So suppose I have created 500 trees are there internally. Okay, now what will happen? Suppose we are passing the, so I have trained my model. Now I'm passing gracious features, male, ages for example 32, salaries for example 10 lakh, occupation is suppose private, okay, and his CIBIL score is suppose 750. Now these features will be passed on to this tree. Similarly on this tree, similarly on this tree. So each tree will be passed, will be having this particular observations passed through. Now what happens? Few of the trees will generate zero, few of the trees will generate one. Some trees will say the target variable prediction is zero. Some trees will say one. Now how they will say, how they do, they will discuss later. Just basic fundamental. Now what will happen? 500 trees will give you some output. Suppose 356 trees saying zero and remaining trees are saying one. Okay, so remaining 152 or whatever 154 trees you have, they are saying one. Now what happens? Finally, voting will happen. So now how many trees are saying zero? 356. So the final class for Girish assigned will be zero. If it is one and here it is 0, then final class assigned will be 1. So this procedure is called as voting or also called as ensemble modeling. Ensemble modeling is basically when you are creating multiple machine learning algorithms. So now decision tree, in a way, we are creating a multiple machine learning algorithms, and finally when we do the voting and we take the final output on the basis of voting is called as ensemble technique. Okay, so this is fundamentally happens into the random forest. Now what happens in a random forest? Now if all my trees are same, then the problem is basically I will not be able to, then there is no point of creating the random forest, because if all the trees are same, you can directly create multiple decision trees and you can do the voting. But if all the trees are same, they will always generate a same output. So now there is a tactics behind creating a random forest algorithm and decision tree within the algorithm, which we will discuss now. So step one is basically here, random sampling with replacement. Now what happens into this step? So suppose you are having a data set available with row 1, row 2, row 3 up to row n, and multiple variables are available, a1, a2, a3 up to am are the features. Now what happens into random sampling with replacement? Suppose you are having 1000 observations are available, then out of 1000 observation, you will be taking a sample, you will be collecting a sample out of this data set of size 100, for example, randomly. So now what will happen? You have collected a data set D1 randomly. So rows came as R10, R3, R15, R4. Then you have collected D2. In D2, you got R1, R1, R100, R500. Then again, you have collected D3. In D3, again, you got R1, R1, R100, R500. So tell me, this DN, D dot dot and D2, all three are having the same rows coming. Is it possible? Yes, guys.
Yes. Yeah, it's possible.
It can be possible, yes.
It is possible, right. Because why it is possible? Because you are doing random sampling, right? So random sampling, it is possible that repetition will happen. Now, what does it mean with replacement and without replacement? Replacement is basically, suppose out of 1000 observations, when I have taken 100 observation, so I have made one data set and these 100 observation I will again keep kept back into the main data set. So again, for a next sample, again the probability of coming R1, R2 or R10 will remain equal. So that is called as with replacement. Without replacement is, once you have collected these 100 observation, then the remaining observation will be into the data set will be 900. Then once again you will do sampling and you will collect 100, then again it will be 800. Okay, so basically we do here into the random forest random sampling with replacement, and because you do random sampling with replacement, you can collect infinite number of samples. Okay, any doubt here till here?
Any yeah, question? Utkarsh, I have one doubt.
Yes.
Surendra here.
Yes, Surendra.
Yeah, can we take different samples? Like suppose in D1, I can take 100 and D2, can I take 150 or 200?
No. So it will be always equal sampling. You have to take equal number of samples always.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so now we will go back to this slide and let's read this. Bootstrap aggregation is also called as bagging. So this particular technique is also called as bootstrap aggregation or bagging. Okay, now given a standard training set D of size N, so given a training set of D of size N, what will happen? Bagging generates M new training sets DI, each of size N dash. So DI will be smaller than your bigger data set and N dash will be smaller than N. By sampling from D uniformly with replacement. By sampling with replacement, some observations may be repeated in each DI. The kind of sample is called as bootstrap sample. The M models are fitted using the above M bootstrap samples and combined by averaging the output or voting or classification. Now what happens? What this guy is saying, now benefit of this particular technique is, now for D1 I will create one decision tree, for D2 I will create one decision tree, for D3 I will create one decision tree, for D4 I will create one decision tree. So now you tell me, when I'm taking random samples with replacement, so the proportion and of zeros and ones will be varying on each of the data set. Agree or not?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Now different splits will come on to different kind of decision trees, right? So now what will happen? You will be having multiple variety of the decision trees with different type of splits will be available. Okay. So now this is one thing. Okay. Now second thing is basically here step one is random sampling with replacement for rows. Now similarly, we also do the sampling of the columns. Now step two is building the tree for each sample with only partial set of m variables being considered at each node. Now what will happen in each of the data set? Once you will be doing this sampling, you will be finally taking the randomly variables also. So in data set one, A1, A5, A7 is coming. In data set two, A2, A6, A9 is coming. A1, A3, A4 is coming. Now tell me, when I'm doing the random sampling, is there a possibility that A1, A5 and A7 can repeat on some other data set as well? Yes. Okay. Now what happens? There is a high probability that now why we have done the sampling of the variables also. This is what I want to make you understand. First thing is basically, suppose this particular case will occur where you are having three data sets in which all the rows are same. But now what happens? It is a very less chance that all the rows are same and all the columns are also same. So now when you will do this second kind of sampling, what will happen? Even though your rows are same, your columns will be different. So again, in a way, this data set is different altogether. So still two level sampling will help you to define a totally unbiased tree. Now, what should be now how many variables we have to take, we will discuss into the later part of the algorithm. So step two is clear to everyone, how we do the sampling. Now there is an interview question: what is random in random forest? So collection of rows is random, selection of your columns is random. So that is why it is called as random forest, because random sampling with replacement happens over the rows and also happens with the features. So clear till here? Any questions?
No.
Okay, fine.
So Rahul this side.
Yes,
so
Rahul.
We can say that we are doing the random sampling. In the first step, we are doing a random sampling with the columns.
Rows.
Rows, sorry. Hmm. And the second step, we are doing random sampling with the columns, right?
Columns, right.
Okay.
Now, third step is basically based on n samples, n trees will be built. Now, as many as samples you have collected, that many number of trees will be built. Each record is classified based on the entry, and final class of each record will be decided on the basis of voting. Okay. Now what happened? Different features, different rows will be generating different kind of output for the features. And finally, we will do the voting, and this voting will be deciding the final class. So can I say there is a less bias as compared to decision tree? Because now what is happening? I am creating different decision trees with different kind of people and with different kind of features. So there is a possibility that one of the decision tree, there is no gender column available at all, and still I am able to get the outputs with the help of two, three variables. So this is how random forest will be more superior as compared to your decision tree. So it avoids that bias of decision tree where this 0-1-0-1 constant proportion create only one tree with one particular kind of features. So now some original papers on RF. So there are some research onto the random forest that the RF error rate depends on two factor. So basically random forest error or misclassification rate. So the correlation between any two trees in the forest, increases the forest error rate. Strength of each individual tree in the forest. A tree with a low error rate is a strong classifier. Increasing the strength of the individual tree decreases the forest error rate. Now tell me, first point, what do you understand from the point? First point, the correlation between any two trees means what?
So the both trees are predicting the same output, almost same output, the classification.
No. What do you mean correlation into a forest?
Right? So column.
A lot of disturbance is coming, Prakash, from your side.
So two columns, right?
Hmm?
Two green. The features.
when they these two trees will be correlated, when I can say these two trees are correlated.
They have same data.
Who told when they have same data?
Abhilash.
Yes, that is the correct answer. So what happens here? R1, R2, R5, R10 came rows, and features came as A1, A3, A5. Here also you got R1, R2, R3, R10, and you got features as A1, A3, A5. So can I say these two trees are correlated? Because now anyways they will generate same output, right? Right or wrong?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So basically this is called as correlation between two trees. Now see, there is a possibility. Now what happens? Okay. This is one thing we will discuss both these things together. Now second point is the strength of each individual tree in the forest. A tree with a low error rate is a strong classifier. So I'll tell you, suppose you are having one decision tree available. Suppose this is a decision tree, and in this decision tree you have these features available. Suppose a CIBIL score, salary, okay, and age, and you have one more decision tree available. Okay, one more decision tree available where you have this column, gender, okay, your city where you stay, or suppose one more column, we can take it up here, suppose your salary again. Okay, now so I have again, suppose Girish's feature. Okay, so I have his age available, suppose 26, salary is 10 lakh, CIBIL score is 750, gender is male, and I have what else? City is suppose Bangalore. Okay, now tell me which decision tree do you think is a strong classifier and which decision tree is a weak classifier? And why you think so? Anyone?
Utkarsh Surendra here. Hmm? Yeah, I think decision tree 1 will be more.
Okay, why do you think like that?
Because all the parameters are numerical.
That should not be the correct answer. But what is the answer? Correct is decision tree 1 is the important classifier. Why? See, whenever somebody will come to your bank, okay, suppose Girish is coming to my bank. So on what basis I will be giving him the loan? On the basis of his gender or on the basis of his CIBIL score?
Okay, you are saying that CIBIL decision tree 1 is more, represents more individual data.
More important features.
Okay.
Suppose if Girish is coming to me, so I will not be giving him a credit card or loan on the basis of his gender, right? Will it make sense for any bank to assign giving a credit card only because the particular person is belonging from Andhra Pradesh or Bangalore or Delhi? Correct. Yeah. So basically here gender and city are coming. But yes, if I have somebody's CIBIL score available, salary available, age available, so these are the most reliable features. Okay. So basically this particular kind of classifiers are called as strong classifier. Okay. And these kind of classifiers are called as weak classifiers. Okay, because it really doesn't contribute heavily onto your particular classification part. Okay, this particular feature will also give some sort of classification probably. It will also say that class is 1 for Girish, and this will also say that class is 1 for Girish on the basis of the features. But the problem is these features are the most important, these features are the least important. Okay, so now what happens, it is saying second point, increasing the strength of the individual tree decrease the forest error rate. Now what happens if you will be creating more and more strong classifiers. So more and more trees are strong classifiers into your forest. Then the strength of the random forest will increase, accuracy will increase. But increasing correlation will decrease the forest error rate. Now suppose what start happening, if my random forest is having a very high correlation rate. So there is a possibility that this kind of tree will be keep on repeating into my for random forest. So out of 500, suppose 490 trees are correlated. Now what problem will be coming? My random forest will be very less accurate. In production, it will fail. Okay. So production, it will basically fail. So that is why we avoid having correlated trees into the random forest. But you cannot avoid it properly. There will be always some of the correlated trees available into your forest. But this is a theory which they have given, statisticians has given, that increasing the correlation may increase your forest error rate. And now what happens? Third point, reducing M reduces both the correlation and the strength. Increasing M will increase both. Somewhere in between is an optimal range of M, usually quite wide. Now, what does this point is saying particularly? So basically what happens, M is what? Number of columns, okay, which you are sample. Columns which you will sample and collect onto the each and every tree. So this guy is saying, if your M, suppose total M is equal to 10. So in your data set, you have 10 columns available. So if your M value will be very high, suppose 9 or 10, then what will happen? Each and every tree which you will be creating will be having almost all the similar columns available. Right or wrong?
Yeah.
Okay. So chances of correlation are high.
High.
Correct? Now, if suppose I am taking M is equal to 1, okay. Now in case of one, what will happen? Only one column will come. Now in this case also correlation will be high because there will be many trees which will be exactly having the same column.
Yeah.
Correct. So in this case also correlation will be high. But suppose if I'll choose M is equal to 3 or 4, then what happens? Permutation combinations I will get. Somewhere I will get A1, A3, somewhere I will get A1, A2, somewhere I will get A2, A5. So this combo will occur. So now what will happen? Chances of correlated trees will decrease. So basically what this third point is saying, so reducing M will reduce both correlation, but it will also reduce the strength. Now why it will reduce the strength? Because what happens? Suppose M is equal to 1. So only on the basis of gender column can I decide that it should be 0 or 1. I cannot decide. Okay. So basically there in between, there is a range of M, which is usually quite wide. Optimal range of M you have to identify. Now how to identify this optimal range, I will teach you into the next upcoming slides. So any questions still here? Okay. Now, this is a code snippet for random forest in Python. Now, what is happening? In sklearn library, you have random forest classifier. In random forest classifier, you are writing bootstrap is equal to true, criteria is equal to Gini, n estimator is equal to 100, maximum feature is equal to auto, max leaf node is equal to 10, min sample split is equal to true. Now, bootstrap is equal to true means you want to do sampling with replacement. So you don't have to worry about sampling with replacement. Internally, random forest will take care of that when you will run this parameter is equal to true. So basically, you have to understand the concept. That's all. Everything will be done in one shot into the random forest. Criteria is equal to Gini means I want to create CART algorithms internally into the random forest. N estimator is basically how many number of trees you want to create. Now this parameter is also one big thing. How you will decide that you have to create 100 trees, 1000 trees, 2000 trees, 10,000 trees. We will discuss how to find it out. Maximum feature. So how many variables you want to decide. So the good thing here is they have given this auto variable. When you will write here auto, automatically internally it will check for the accuracy and it will assign a optimal parameter. Otherwise, this particular thing you can find it out with one more technique which I will be introducing you to you today. Otherwise, this is a manual way how we have decided into the decision tree. You have to do manual hit and try. Here also it is manual hit and try with respect to accuracy, but here I will teach you today grid search CV. So grid search CV is a very great invention into the analytics industry for sorting out these kind of hit and trial methods. What is this max leaf nodes and min sample split parameters? So this is basically the parameters you are assigning for your decision tree, that maximum observation into a leaf node should be 10, and minimum sample split is equal to true is basically it will be keep on splitting until and unless it will reach this max leaf node criteria. So here you can write some number also as you have written into the decision tree algorithm. Okay. Now, something called as out of bag estimate of error rate, OOB error rate. Now what happens? Sample left out of kth tree is classified using the K tree. Assume J cases are misclassified. Proportion of that J is not equal to true classes averaged all over the cases is out of bag estimate of error rate. So now it is a very easy definition. Okay. Who will explain me what is loss in decision tree? What is loss in decision tree? Anyone?
Cases of misclassification.
Okay, perfect. So can you elaborate more? Yes, cases of misclassification. More detailed, can you give me?
So if your model accuracy is suppose 84%, so your loss is around 16%. So your model has...
No. Okay, you have told correctly, partially correct. It is not related to model accuracy. Loss is something we always calculate onto the node. We don't calculate onto the overall model. We calculate onto a node basis.
Okay.
Yeah, if we have... Based
on observations, right?
How you guys can forget loss? So loss is the number of cases misclassified in a given node, right? So there will be a separate loss. There will be a separate loss. What you are saying, that is misclassification. Misclassification is calculated onto the overall decision tree. Accuracy, 1 minus accuracy will give you the error rate of that particular decision tree. Loss is calculated onto the overall nodal basis. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
So... all of you understand loss, right? What is loss? Correct?
Yeah.
Yes. Now, what happens? Now, here in decision tree case, what will happen? You will be creating multiple decision trees. Decision tree 1, decision tree 2, then decision tree 3, 4, 5. Each of these decision tree will be generating some loss, right or wrong?
Yes.
Correct. Wherever you guys are not able to get it, just stop me and ask the questions. Otherwise, I will be keep on going into the flow. So each and every decision tree will be generating a loss. Now, what happens here? Suppose this decision tree generated as a loss as 5. This generated as 8. This generated as 10, 18, 5, 21. Now, all these loss values combined together. Okay. And average, taken average. So if I have to tell like what is the loss or what is the error rate of my random forest, so what I will do, I will calculate the loss of each and every available tree into my random forest, and the average of those loss I will call it as a out of bag error rate. So basically, out of bag error rate is nothing, but it is basically the J classes are misclassified onto the particular node. The proportion J is not equal to true class averaged over all cases in this random forest is called as OOB estimate of error rate. So basically the average loss calculated from all the trees together is called as out of bag error rate onto a forest level. So forest level, now if somebody wants to ask me what is the loss onto the forest level, so I have defined a new parameter called as out of bag error rate, which will give you the overall forest level error rate. In decision tree cases, it is called as loss. So it is something like population and sample. So both population and sample are similar thing, but the one place we represent it as a X bar, somewhere we represent it as a mu. So similarly, for representing the loss into the random forest, I have coined a new term, out of bag error rate. This is clear? Okay. So now what happens? We will just go along with the code as well, and as well as theory also. Now what happens, I am having one data set available. So this is my data set, breast cancer data set. Now in this data set, what happens, I have these many parameters available. See, lot of parameters are there. Okay, texture worst, fractal dimension underscore SC. Now I want to create a model. So diagnosis is a target variable. Now I want to create a model where I can predict like what kind of cancer is that on the basis of these parameters given. So you have two variables available, M and B. M is basically malignant and B is basically benign. So benign is a health domain term for cancer type. So benign is a one cancer type, malignant is another type of cancer. So I want to make a model where if somebody will pass the features and report into the system, system will be able to identify that if it is a malignant type cancer or benign type cancer. Okay, so now on this particular, so this is again a classification problem. You want to define a class benign and malignant on the basis of features. Now what happens, okay, so here what I'm doing, I'm dropping the ID column. So sorry, I'm not dropping the ID column, I'm converting ID column as an index. Right now you are seeing index as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm making ID column as a displayed index. So in a way, I'm removing the ID column. Then again, I have one column available, unnamed 32, where all the values are NaN. So this particular variable also, I will be dropping in the downside. Now, breast cancer diagnosis is equal to diagnosis dot map M is to 1, B is to 0. So what I'm doing into this line, can anybody explain me?
So we are replacing the string to the int type.
So we are basically converting the strings to the 0101 type. Okay, so you have yes, no, win or loss. So you have to always convert it into the 0101 format. So this is also one more type of way of converting your data into 0101. You can similarly convert gender column as well. So you can use this particular method also into your upcoming analysis. Okay.
Call it encryption, of course.
Yes, it is called as encryption of the data. Okay. So now, missing value check. So I'm checking the missing value. So I have 569 missing values into this column. So what I will do, I will delete this particular column from my data frame. Now, if you will again plot your data sort, now your IDs became the index number and you don't have this unnamed column available here. Okay. Now, dimensions I'm putting and I'm just seeing the data structure type. Okay. Float 64, all are float 64. Fine. And this diagnosis column became int 64. Okay. 569 values and 31 columns are available. Now, this is a describe function. You all know what describe function does. So we will not discuss about that. Now, what is happening here? Can anybody explain me these three lines line by line? Anyone?
So we are separating out the features and target variables. Okay. So on the first column,
So, and what we are doing into train test split, we are splitting our data feature space and feature classes. We are splitting into the ratio of 80 by 20. Okay. So 80% will be the training size, 20% will be the test size. And I'm giving random state is equal to 42. You can give any number. It is a seed we are providing for random sampling. Okay. Now this is for removing the warning. So this you can avoid. Now what happens? Okay. I have directly gone on to this particular thing. So, okay, this I will come back here. Now what happens? Basically, you are assigning a random forest classifier. So now random forest classifier object you are creating. Now after creating this object, now our basically out of bag error rate, if you will see, out of bag error rate is one of the feature which basically help you to identify how many trees you want to create. Okay, so now how many trees you want to create, you can find it out from this particular graph. Okay, so now what this particular graph does, basically here, if you will see, you will be plotting number of trees. So this x-axis will be giving you n estimators and this out of bag error rate will be giving you the total average error rate as you are keep on increasing the number of trees. So it will start from zero and it will be keep on creating 1,000 trees. Now you have to see where your error became constant. Now wherever your error became constant, that many number of trees you have to finally take for your decision tree. So now here, can you tell me where your error is becoming constant fluctuation becoming constant? How many number of trees you will take?
400 to 600.
Probably in between 400 to 500 or 600 I will be taking. Because more than 500, you take any number, your error will remain same, almost same, into a particular constant region. So now, tell me when my error will remain same after 400 trees also, then what is the need of plotting this out of bag error rate? Why I can't directly randomly take 800 or 900 trees? What is the benefit of doing this particular analysis? Can anyone think of it and can tell?
Yeah, we might have decision trees with the higher correlation values, like same columns can be used in across decision trees, same set of columns.
Okay, perfect. Basically, no, that is not the question. Question is basically why I want to find out the n underscore estimator, number of trees to be calculated. See, correlation thing can be controlled via the number of variables. These are basically number of trees, basically how many number of trees I want to create. Correlation will be controlled via the number of variables. Yes.
Then more the number of trees, the heavier would be the model.
Right. Correct. More elaboration can you do onto this?
So more the number of trees, heavier would be the model, and more would be the training time for that particular model.
Perfect.
Unnecessarily.
Perfect.
Overfitting also.
Perfect. So basically this is the correct answer, because more the number of trees, more will be the model training time. Now suppose you have taken 1000 trees and you have trained your model, the model size will become large. When you will be creating a pickle file for deploying it into the production, this file size will become 1 GB, 1.5 GB. But probably if you would have used 400 trees, there was a chance that with 200 MB model only you can be able to do the predictions, but unnecessarily it will become 1 GB, 2 GB, 2 TB model. Okay, so it will reduce the training time, it will reduce your model running time, it will reduce the size of your model, it will not make your model bulky, because anyways random forest is a bulky model. So we need to optimize it, we need to find out the optimal value for n underscore estimator. So this is why we are doing this analysis. So what happens into this analysis? Basically, we are doing SAT params. So SAT params, what we are doing, we want to calculate the OOB score true. So now OOB score true you have to write, and I am giving min estimator is equal to 15, max estimator is equal to 100. So what I'm telling to my algorithm, you start with 15 trees and create up to 1000 trees. Suppose what will happen now how you will decide this range itself, that I have to start from 15 to 1000. So look, 15 is okay, 15, 20 you can define, definitely that is easy, but how you will define that I have to go up to 500, 800 or 1000? How you will decide that? Anyone?
Depending on number of observations and the features that you have in your asset.
No. So this is again hit and try. Now what happens? Suppose first I will create a decision tree. First I will write here 15 to 300. Now when I will write 15 to 300, I will get this kind of graph till here. Now what you are seeing a fluctuation. Okay, a continuous fluctuation you are seeing into the out of bag error rate. Then what you have to do, you have to go back and you have to increase this number to 600. Now up to 600 also, what is happening, you are seeing certain sort of fluctuations. So for safer side, I will plot again for 800 to 900. So now I am seeing after 400, there is a constant fluctuation. It is not going beyond a particular range. So that is how I will be deciding these numbers. You will not give in one shot 10,000 or 20,000. Otherwise your model will be keep on running for out of bag error generation. So now suppose up to 1000 also you are getting fluctuation, then you increase it to 1500. So this is how hit and try you have to do to find out the number of trees has to be defined. Okay. Now what happens, then what I'm doing, this particular min estimator and max estimators plus one, what I'm doing, I'm taking these parameters, with these parameters I'm passing it to the model. So fit underscore RF is nothing but my random forest model, where object I have created for fit underscore RF, and I'm fitting my training data and testing training data set, basically training features and your target variable. okay, and then finally this will calculate OOB error rate is equal to 1 minus fit underscore RF dot OOB underscore score. So this will calculate the error rate, 1 minus accuracy will give you the OOB error rate, and finally this is a particular plot for plotting this particular graph. So you can also print the number. So number is basically OOB underscore series. So for 400 trees, what is the average? So till here, what is the average out of bag error rate is 0.04835. So you can get this number, but number will not help you in this particular case. So here visualizations will help you more, but number is also possible to be printed. Okay. So this is the basically funda of out of bag error rate, which will help you to decide what is the maximum number of trees you have to find out. Okay. Now, another one more great thing what random forest gives you, one feature of random forest is variable importance. So there is a function variable underscore importance where your random forest can tell you which variables are the most important variables. So basically it can tell you that CIBIL score the best variable, and then gender is the second best variable, and then your another basically age is third best variable. It can do this also. So can you tell me how it might be able to find out the important variables into random forest? Can you think with respect to decision tree, and can you explain me how it is happening?
By creating a Gini score.
Okay, perfect. So now can you relate it? So basically in decision tree, how you will define that which variable is important?
Target variable.
No. Target variable is just 0101.
Training data.
Training data, how you will identify that which variable is important?
Based on its features. Features of the training.
So features data is basically you are telling that this feature is important. How your model will identify which feature is important in decision tree? Gini score. So what does Gini score does?
Like which has the highest
whichever has the highest,
like which is the highest Gini parameter, that is.
So if a parameter will get the highest Gini gain, then what will happen into the decision tree with that parameter?
It will split the decision tree on that column.
That will become the first split, right?
Yes.
And so on. So can I say that the first split is the most important parameter? Second split is the second most important parameter? Can I say that? Agree or not?
Yes.
Okay. Now can you think in the same perspective, and can you tell me how random forest would have been calculating the variable importance? So I told you there is a loss something in decision tree, and random forest calculate the average loss, and it says it is as a OOB rate. Now can you think in same perspective, and can you tell how you think might be random forest detecting the variable importance?
Losses and length of the tree.
No.
Okay, if a column is present in across multiple decision trees, and the OOB is less for those decision trees with that column.
Okay, again your answer is correct, but OOB error rate we will not be discussing here. OOB is just for finding out how many number of trees you want to create. Now what happens in decision tree one? There is a data set D1, there is a data set D2, there is a data set D3, there is a data set D4. Suppose what happens here, my Gini gain calculation happens and decision tree got created, and here I got first split at gender, second split at age, third split at credit transaction. Here I got it first split at again gender, second split at CIBIL score, and third split at suppose age. Here again I got first split at gender, second split, suppose I got it onto the occupation, and third split I got onto the salary. Now, can you tell me which variable is the most important variable in this by seeing this tree? If I'll say this is a forest.
Gender.
Why gender? Because in most of the trees, when Gini gain calculation is happening, now gender is coming as the first split. In out of 500 trees, 300 trees, gender is coming as the first split. So now my most important variable into the random forest is gender. Now this is where you are getting a robust output. Now what was happening into the decision tree? You were having a one data set on the basis of 0101. You were getting gender was the first split. But now here on each tree, I have different combination of variables and I have different combination of rows. Now target variable is also varying into the proportion. And still gender is coming as the first split onto most of the trees. So can I say there is a robust analysis that yes, gender is a, I will be more sure here as compared to decision tree that gender is the most important column, and this is what is the power of your random forest, and this is where random forest is superior with respect to your decision tree. So similarly, how many times age occurred as a first column or second column, how many times CIBIL score occurred, it will calculate all these things and it will be able to plot for you variable importance in graphical manner or in another manner, which I will show you into the code. So there is a this function, variable underscore importance function, where you have to pass your fit underscore RF model. This is a random forest model. It will just give you the most important variables in a descending order. Okay, so this is also one of the great thing about the random forest, where it can give you the most important variable into your data set contains for the prediction purpose. Okay, so this is one feature of variable importance. Same thing, you can read it here. Now grid search CV. Now I told you that you have to do hit and try in decision tree with respect to different parameters, and you have to calculate the accuracy and you have to check for the optimal parameter. Now statisticians has come up with one more algorithm, which is called as grid search CV. Now grid search CV, what it does, it will calculate the optimal parameters automatically for you in one shot. Now what is happening here? So basically these are the parameters which we can give into the random forest: max depth, bootstrap, maximum features, criteria. Now what happens? Max depth, you define here the list 2, 3, 4. Bootstrap, true or false. Max features, auto, square root, log of 2, none. So square root is basically, suppose you have 100 features, then square root is 10, so it will try with 10 features. Log 2, basically log 2 of 100, it will, that many features it will try the tree. Criteria is equal to Gini or entropy, C4.5 tree and card tree. Now what will happen in grid search CV? What you will do, you will pass your model. This is your random forest model, fit underscore RF. CV is equal to 10 is what? Cross validation. So what I'm telling to my model, grid search CV, that sir, you take random forest model and do the cross validation as well, and also take this parameter list, and this parameter list you take and you run it, you make different kind of random forest with these parameter. So it will create one random forest with max depth 2, bootstrap true, max feature auto and criteria Gini. Similarly, it will create another forest with max depth 2, bootstrap false, max features auto, criteria Gini. Then again it will create max depth 2, bootstrap true, max feature square root, criteria is equal to Gini. So lot of permutation combination which you were doing manually into the case of decision tree will be happening automatically here once you will define the list. Now 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 10, you can write any number of trees here. As you will be keep on increasing these numbers, your model running time will be keep on increasing. But here the good part is you don't have to do any hit and try. And finally, when you will pass your training data, it will give you the best parameter. Best parameter is bootstrap true, criteria Gini, max depth 3, max feature log 2, and time taken 6 seconds. So in 6 seconds for this data set, this particular grid search CV algorithm is identify the most optimal parameters. So here you don't have to do any hit and try. Now same grid search CV algorithm you can also use into decision tree classifier. So your assignment here is you have to implement grid search CV for decision tree model. Random forest, I will show you how to implement. Yes, Abhilash, what you were asking?
Yeah, okay, sure. For the assignment where you asked to increase the accuracy of the model in previous class, right? I think I did the same with max depth between 2 to 20 by defining a range and sample leaf and leaf node length. I gave a parameter of range.
Got it.
And I ran a for loop for that with the highest accuracy.
So what the accuracy you got?
I think it's increases with the depth and decreases with the leaf and sample node.
So basically that is what I want you to do first case into decision tree, because what happens when you will go for an interview, people will ask you into the interview how you will find out the optimal parameter for random forest, and 99% of the people, they give answer, I will use grid search CV. So basically the point of time when you say grid search CV, you are telling to the interviewer, sir, I don't know anything internal about random forest. I will just directly blindly run grid search CV and I will just try to find out optimal parameter. You have to always start by saying, okay, how you will calculate the N estimator. N estimators I will be calculating via the out of bag error rate. Explain what is out of bag error rate. Then you tell how you will calculate the features. So features is also again hit and try. But in random forest, we have auto function, which will take care of your maximum features. Then we will try to put criteria as Gini or entropy, where we will be finding out what is the most optimal number. So you have to first discuss about the parameters. Okay, what all these parameters available into this decision tree? All these parameters you have to discuss, that you have to manually do hit and try. After that, in the last, you have to add that there is one more algorithm called as grid search CV, which can in one shot give us all the optimal parameters by running the model. So you have to explain grid search CV always for any algorithm in the last, not into the start. Now, one more parameter here is n underscore jobs is equal to 3. So n underscore jobs is equal to 3 is basically I'm telling you when you will be making permutation combination. So at a time parallelly, you make 3 permutations and combinations and run them into the backend. So this particular parameter you have to decide on the basis of your number of cores available into your CPU. Suppose if you have 4 core CPU, you will be giving this n underscore jobs is equal to 3. Suppose if you have octa core processor, 8 core CPU, you will be giving n underscore jobs is equal to 7. Why not 8 and why not 4 is basically a computer science knowledge. Basically, one core will be always consumed by your operating system for maintaining the applications into your system. If you will write here 4, your system speed will go down and your system may crash also. Okay, so very see, if it is your laptop or your system, then it is fine. You can do experiments. But when you will be working on cloud systems, so make sure whenever you are running this particular parameter, what is the value you are deciding? So when you are taking a 24 core CPU, you have to make this particular job is 24. So on cloud, when you have 24 core CPU, the running time will be less. When you will be having less core CPU, running time will increase. So any question here? Grid search CV.
I would cut. This grid search CV works on time taken as well or only accuracy?
No, time taken is how much total time it has taken for running the model. It is only based on accuracy. So first it will do calculation of accuracy for max depth to bootstrap true, max feature auto, criteria Gini. So it got accuracy 90%. Then next combination it will calculate accuracy, then again for another combination it will calculate accuracy. For whichever combo it will be getting the highest accuracy, that will be your optimal parameters. And it is also doing the cross validation internally as well.
It is not considering time taken.
No, it is not considering time.
Hi, because I have a question on the same line, the grid search CV class. Why did we take CV10? CV is equal to 10.
CV is your cross-validation. K-fold cross-validation, which we have discussed into decision tree.
Yeah,
so
10
here,
times split, right?
10 times split. So K-fold. So you can define here 20, 30, but problem I told you, it will increase the model running time.
Okay.
So generally we go with 10 value as a thumb rule.
Sure.
But it doesn't, it's not a hard and fast rule. Yes, you can go with 20, 30 also, but you have to decide this value right now. See, I have how many values? 537 values I have, I think. Okay, total number of rows. Now 537 divided by 10, I think 53 or 52 values in each set it will be containing. Now what will happen if you will be, if you will make it CV is equal to 20 or 30, then each validation set will be having only 5 or 10 observation available, which will not a sensible decision. At least 50 to 100 values should be available into a data set of this size. So define accordingly. So mostly we go with 10 number as a thumb rule, but you can increase it also.
Okay. I have another question in the parameter distribution dictionary.
Okay.
For the decision tree, so maximum depth we will pass in the list like 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, right? we can pass it.
Right. You can pass it. See, this is for yours to show you. I have just taken these parameters. So my model will be just in 6 seconds, it will give me result. Now, as you will be keep on increasing, model running time will increase. So you, when you will be hit and trying, you have to increase the number. So probably what you can do, you can try with 2, 3, 4 and you can see what is the accuracy you are getting. Then probably what you can do, you can basically increase it to 6, 7, 8 also, and hit and try you can do, and you can take it up accordingly.
Okay. And for the sample leaf as well, right? Minimum leaf. And minimum split.
Yes, that also you can define here. If you will not define, then what will happen? By default values which are available, that default values it will consider. So default values are already 10 and 100 into the algorithm internally. So you can overwrite. So this is a over what we called as this function overcalling. What we call it? I forgot the name. In C programming, we have something called as overriding. Function overriding. Parameter overriding. I forgot the name. Function overloading. Okay. So that is called as function overloading. So basically what happens, there is a parameter already bootstrap is equal to true. Now when you will pass false, that will be overridden by the system call.
Okay. I have another question. Sorry.
One more, just one thing. Yeah. Now what happens here, you have defined 2, 3, 4. So now here you got max depth 3 as the most optimal. So anyways, you have defined 4 and 5 after that, and it has not taken 4 and 5. So basically now you don't have to define more values. But suppose if it would have taken 4 as maximum depth, then what I will do in, again, I will change this parameter to 4, 5, 6. Now again, if it has defined here 6 as a max depth, again, I have to put 7, 8. So this is how you have to go. Okay. Yes.
And the time taken is for the optimal parameters, not just like, okay.
No. So optimal, not optimal. It is for overall grid search CV, how much time it has taken to run.
Okay. Thank you.
So any other questions? So grid search CV is the best your savior into analytics domain. You always use grid search CV, and any kind of algorithm you will be able to optimize in one shot. But remember, whenever you are going into an interview, you don't have to say that optimal parameters I will find out from grid search CV. That is a last answer. Otherwise, you have to always go via the different kind of parameters and matrices. Now, measuring RF performance is, again, you will be having confusion matrix, you will be having area under the curve, and this we will discuss into the code. So why I like RF technique, typically you will have 300 to 500 variables for modeling. So basically when you have 300 to 500 variables for modeling, it is difficult to go in each and every variable and maintain a decision tree. So random forest will help you in those kind of cases. With techniques like logistic regression, you will be forced to drop variables because of multicollinearity. This we will discuss now. Business users will have their own hypothesis and would want collinear variables to be the part of. Collinear is basically correlated variables. Okay. Now, what happens here? You have to wait till logistic regression modeling, then I will discuss with you these techniques. Let's leave it for now. Ensemble techniques like RF helps you build model by considering multitude of predictor variables permutation. Challenges is basically you do not get a equation, somewhat of a black box, and hence not used in some industries like banks for risk modeling. Now the problem with the random forest is, even though random forest is a superior technique as compared to decision tree, random forest is a black box technique. So what does it mean by the black box technique is that in a random forest, basically on this particular tree, in this particular tree, what all observations are available, you cannot identify. If there is row 1, row 2, row 4, and here row 5 and row 6. So there is no way to identify which tree contains which rows. There is no way to identify which tree contains which columns. There is no way to identify which tree is generating which particular output. Suppose this tree is generating 0, this tree is generating 1, this tree is generating 0. What will be the final class of your random forest in this case?
Zero.
Voting. It is called as voting or ensemble. Okay, now you cannot identify which tree has generated 0 and which trees has generated 1. So this is why that random forest algorithm is called as black box technique. Now what happens in some of the industries, like usually into retail and marketing and digital marketing, they are okay with these kind of algos because they want superior algos. Now problem happens into health domain and into the risk modeling domain. So for example, you went with your analysis and you told, sir, as per my analysis, my model is saying I should give the credit card to Girish. Okay, we should offer the credit card to Girish. Now my manager is asking, can you explain me why do you think that Girish should be having the credit card? So now what you can do, you can just simply plot your classification tree, card tree. Okay, and what you can say, sir, why I am saying this, because now Girish is lying into this particular green node, and how he is reaching, he's inactive less than 6 months, his account balance is greater than $1,000, he has done last credit transaction, and that is why I think that he should be given a credit card. But in case of random forest, if you will plot the same model, even though it will be more superior, even though it will be having more accuracy, what will happen? Explainability is not possible into the case of random forest. So many of the companies, basically what they does, they avoid using RF technique. So now, which sometimes what happens whenever some people are coming to interview, I ask them, which algorithm is the most important algorithm is in machine learning, or which one is more superior, decision tree or random forest? So what you will answer? This is a question I usually ask to the interview candidates, like which technique is most important, random forest or decision tree?
So if you want to go with accuracy, you can follow random forest, but if you want to have a complete traceability, then you must go with this.
Yes. Algorithm. So basically, no algorithm is bad or no algorithm is good. Each and every algorithm is having their own application and their own features and their own problems. Now, decision tree is having the problem with this because proportion will vary tomorrow, splits will change. Okay. But it is having a good explainability because of that graph structure we get. But in random forest, even though it is superior, it will give us the confidence. Yes. Okay. Which all are the important variables. So this variable importance, you cannot rely from decision tree, but I can rely on random forest technique for variable importance finding out. So here random forest is more superior. So each and every algorithm is having their own pros and cons. If your customer is saying that he is not worrying about the model explainability part, he is only worrying about the accuracy and superiority of model, go with the RF, otherwise decision tree. So in an interview, never say decision tree is bad or random forest is good or random forest is good or that is bad. So that don't do. Just try to give a debate kind of answer. Okay. So that is what all about random forest discussion. Now what happens? I will just walk you through this code also. Now what happened here? What I'm doing, I have taken this random forest classifier and I'm doing hyperparameter optimization using grid search CV same way. So what I'm doing, I'm just passing and it is giving me the most optimal parameters. Now what I'm doing, I'm doing fit underscore RF set underscore parameters. So these parameters I'm setting up Gini log 2 and max depth is equal to 3. Now what happens here? So basically what I'll do now, I don't know. So this model, which I have created here, this model is having right now your n estimator is equal to 10. So it is a default value of your n estimators in the tree. Now what I want to do, I want to find out optimal value of n estimator. So with these parameters, with these optimal parameters, now what I will do, I will create a out of bag error rate function and I will find out how many trees I have to create. So now you got value as suppose 400 is the optimal. You can try with 400, 450, 500 as well. Now I will write 400 trees here and I will again retrain my model. So when I will retrain my model, what will happen? And max depth is equal to 3, criteria is equal to Gini, max feature is equal to log 2 and n estimator is equal to 400. You will get your new model developed. Okay. Now model has been trained. Now I want to identify the variable importance. So this is for basically, this is the function. This function is just for plotting purpose. So you can put it with respect to the plotting. So if you will see this, so one is basically I'm plotting variable importance, importance underscore RF, indices underscore RF and name underscore index. Okay. So print underscore underscore where underscore important. So this function I have written to plot it in this particular way. Another one is you can plot it into a graphical manner also. So graphical manner also, it is plotting area underscore worst, perimeter underscore worst. And basically it is based on this. The feature area underscore worst has a mean decrease in impurity of 0.12. Then 0.12095, here it is 98, then 1110.7. So it is keep on decreasing. So this thing I have plotted into the graphical manner also. So in a graphical manner also, you can say many of the times you will get the industry analysis only for variable importance. So many of the times what happens, many customers comes and they ask us that we don't want to build any model. We just want to find out which are the most important parameter which are affecting our target variable. So for example, simply one customer came to us, they were a marketing company. Okay, and they were putting a lot of money into marketing campaign. So they were doing a lot of things like poster campaign. They were writing poster for some of the products. They were writing content for some of the products. They were giving the promotional offers and buy one get one free. So they wanted to identify which particular method is giving me the highest output. So they just wanted to identify which feature is the most important. So you have to just do this much of analysis and you have to give it them. Okay, so that is how basically your random forest is helping for finding out the variable importance. Then simply prediction happens from the predict function. You have your RF underscore model. You have to pass your test set. You will got all the predictions into prediction underscore RF. Now this is a different type of confusion matrix. Different confusion matrix I have plotted. 0 has been predicted as 0.70, 1 has been predicted as 1.40. So you can calculate the accuracy. Accuracy will be 70 plus 40 divided by 70 plus 40 plus 3 plus 1 into 100 will give you the accuracy. Or if I want to calculate accuracy directly, there is a score function as well. So you can see from the score function how to calculate the accuracy. Now, this is the score function. So here what I'm calculating, score function will give you the accuracy as 96%. Now, if you want to calculate error rate will be 1 minus accuracy. So here I'm calculating the error rate, which is 1 minus accuracy, which is coming as 0.0351. Now, area under the curve, again, you have to calculate FPR and TPR by using ROC function, predicted data, and basically with respect to your test data, and when you will pass it into AUC function. So you will get this curve. So this is a new function I have plotted, designed for plotting this kind of graph. So there is another graph into your decision tree. There is another graph. Now, which particular function you want to use, which particular graph you like, that particular graph code or that particular confusion matrix code you guys can use. Now, area under the curve here is 99%. So nice model. So basically, what is my conclusion? My accuracy is coming 93 and my model accuracy is also coming 96. Area under the curve is coming as 99%. So it is one of the best model I have created with the help of Grid Search CV, and it is able to classify zeros as zero and ones as ones. Now, this is now new function, which is called as classification report. So basically this classification report is you can generate it via this function, classification underscore report. So this is a inbuilt function into Python which can basically plot this kind of report. So this kind of report will give you these parameters: value, precision, recall, F1 score and support. So higher the F1 score, better will be your model. So now Bannon, what does it say? Recall. So recall is basically one is predicted as one, or we can say Bannon has been predicted as Bannon. So how many times Bannon has been predicted as Bannon is 96%. Malignant is predicted as malignant 98%. So recall values and F1 score values are 97-95%. How many times wrong prediction happened will be shown by precision. So this is also one more method where you can get more variable fundamental available with you, and you can run it. So these all are about your random forest. Now, what I want you to do, you will have to use this Grid Search CV into your decision tree model. See how you can implement into decision tree model, and on the data set which is available for decision tree, on this particular data set, you have to develop a random forest model and see, can I increase the accuracy of my data set by using the random forest model instead of decision tree. So that is the assignment you have to do, hit and try. So that is all about your random forest. So any questions with respect to random forest or anything? Yes, guys, any questions from Random Forest, from the slides? Anything you want to know? So if nobody is having the questions, okay, so you have to go and read it on your own. Then Grits, Random Forest is an easy algorithm if you understand decision tree, okay? So not a very tough algorithm, but it is one of the favorite topic of interviewers, because reason is when they will ask you the Random Forest, they will be able to ask you two algorithms. So you will be explaining them Random Forest, and then from Random Forest, they will easily, smoothly go into decision tree, and they will be able to understand two algorithms out of one. So it is one of the most favorite algorithms of interviewers, Random Forest. So remember this, and all the concepts which I told you, this sampling and all that, this, all these things happens internally. You don't have to worry about anything, but basically you should know what is the concept behind the seed, how Random Forest is basically working internally, and you have to decide accordingly optimal parameters and everything. Okay, so I am done from my side. If any questions are there, you can ask.